Good morning, colleagues, and those who are visiting the Finance Committee in the public gallery, and welcome to the 15th meeting of the in 2016 of the Finance and Constitution Committee. As usual, can I ask members to just make sure that their mobile phones are switched off or at least put into a mode that won't interfere with proceedings. The first item on agenda today is to decide whether to take items 4 and 5 in private. Are members agreed?
Yes,
sir. I can confirm that members are agreed. Our next piece of business is to take evidence on the Scottish Parliamentary Corporate Body's proposed budget for 2017-18. And from Jackson Carlisle, MSP, who's from the member, obviously, of the Corporate Body, Sir Paul Grice, Chief Executive of the Parliament, Derek Crawl, who's the Group Head of Finance and Security. Members I know have received copies of a letter from the presiding officer providing details of the Corporate Body's budget bid. I welcome our witnesses to the meeting this morning. Jackson Carlock, I understand you might want to make this a short opening statement.
I will, yes. Thank you, convener.
Please feel free.
Good morning, colleagues. I come before you as a corporate body ingenue, having just assumed a responsibility following the resignation of my colleague Alec Johnson in circumstances you will all understand. Somewhat to my surprise, I discovered I would have the finance portfolio and would be before you about 10 days later presenting the corporate body budget. But I thank you for the opportunity. Sorry?
It's delightful to see you.
Yeah. I thank you for the opportunity to present details of the budget for 2017-18. This is the budget for the second year of the new session of the Parliament. You'll have seen in the letter from the presiding officer setting out our budget submission for 17-18 that he makes reference to the successful programme of savings that was delivered by the SPCB over the previous parliamentary session. This programme achieved 10% real terms reductions in budgets and staff numbers from the 2010-11 baseline to 2015-16, whilst consistently delivering against our strategic plan and supporting demanding programmes of parliamentary business. This new session brings new challenges, and the corporate body has a duty to ensure that the Parliament is properly resourced to meet its requirements. As a member and colleague since 2007, I certainly detect a renewed energy in the Parliament in this new session. And this is partly due to the infectious enthusiasm of so many new MSPs. We have a record 51 new, or nearly new, as we used to say in the motor trade, members elected in May this year. And indeed, several are sitting opposite me this morning. Moreover, I sense that as we enter session five, the Parliament has now really matured as an institution and continues to evolve, particularly as it assumes substantial new powers in taxation and welfare. Now, we're already seeing evidence of this renewed energy in the volume of business, with significantly increased numbers of questions, motions and proposals for members' bills. And I can see no reason at this stage to suggest that these increased levels will not be sustained throughout this session. Turning to the budget itself, the headline figures for total expenditure excluding non-cash items show an increase of 0.8 million from the 2016-17 budget and are 1.4 million higher than the indicative forecast provided to the Finance Committee in December last year. The increase from the previous indicative forecast is due to two specific items which fall outside the SPCB's control. Firstly, new statutory functions for the Ombudsman, and secondly, project costs for system and marketing costs for the new lobbying register. Excluding these, the SPCB has set a budget for 2017-18 in line with its previous submission. With regard to pay, our budget submission is based on a continuation of the prudent pay restraint we have shown previously. 2017-18 forms the second year of a two-year agreement negotiated with the trade unions on pay for SPCB staff, and the budget calculations incorporate the agreed uplift base scales in that pay deal. Schedule 3 in our budget submission includes an analysis of additional posts proposed in the parliamentary service, and we'd be happy to expand on that in our evidence today. As reported to the Finance Committee in previous years, the Scottish Parliamentary Salaries Scheme now directly links MSP salaries to public sector pay rises in Scotland, using the annual survey of hours and earnings published by ONS. Using this index, I can confirm that an increase of 1.8% will be applied in April 2017. Other costs, we've provided analysis of other non-pay in various schedules which form part of our budget submission, and I don't propose to repeat the information in my opening remarks. However, I would like to draw the committee's attention to the following two areas. Commissioners and Ombudsman, as members are aware, the SPCB is charged with the oversight of these bodies, and the Finance Committee has always taken a keen interest in this area of our budget. The proposed 2017-18 budget for office holders amounts to £9.6 million, representing a substantial increase of £1.3 million, or 15%, 2% on the approved 2015-16 budget. However, it is important to recognise that this is largely because new statutory functions have been transferred to the Ombudsman in respect of the Social Welfare Fund and social work complaints. We welcome the involvement of other committees in scrutinising aspects of the various office holders which are not within our remit. For example, next month the Local Government and Communities Committee and the Health and Sport Committee will take evidence from the Ombudsman, and the Equalities and Human Rights Committee will take evidence from the Human Rights Commission. The SPC is proposing to set aside a £1 million contingency, regarded as prudent, for emergencies, anticipated potential costs that are not yet certain, and emerging cost pressures. We consider this will be tight in the current climate of uncertainty and is something less of a contingency than has applied previously, but have set this level to maintain the overall budget submission within the previous indicative forecast on a like-for-like basis. As set out in our submission, the SPCB is submitting its budget to the Finance Committee in advance of the publication of the draft Scottish budget on December the 15th, which is unusual. We will consider what this tells us of the pressures on future years' budgets and will respond accordingly. However, in advance of that, we have provided an indicative forecast for 2017-18 based on the latest Office for Budget Responsibility estimate of CPI. Finally, I'd like to place on record the corporate body's appreciation of the work done by the Chief Executive and his team in preparing the SPCB's 2017-18 budget submission. And as a new member, can I say that I've been immediately struck by the professionalism of the senior staff that serve us in the Parliament. And that concludes my opening remarks, Convener. I hope I've managed to convey a sense of the responsible approach we've taken to setting the Parliament's budget. And both I and my colleagues are more than happy now to answer any of the questions the committee may have.
Thank you, Jackson Carlow, for the opening, and particularly the issue around renewed energy of new and nearly new members. I hope you'd accept that some of us veterans have still got some fuel left in the tank as far as that process is concerned.
I'm willing to be persuaded.
The letter from the presiding officer states that in your budget for 2018 reflects the emerging demands arising as a result of the complex new powers, obviously, the Scottish Parliament will have in future. Can you say a bit more about how you've dealt with that in terms of how you've set your budget, particularly in the light of some of the work that's been led by John McCormack and the review under being set by the presiding officer? Because obviously that may be where some of your contingency money lies for some of these issues that may emerge from that review.
I don't think that the contingency does make provision for completely unforeseen contingencies that might arise out of the presiding officer's review, nor does it make any contingency that might arise out of anything relating to Brexit negotiations. I think that at this stage, these are just too tenuous for us to be able to make any meaningful suggestion. In addition, I think that any costs arising from these would probably spread beyond the immediate period ahead, and there would be an opportunity for us to reflect these in the next budget submission that we make. Paul?
Yeah, what we have done, just to sort of reinforce that point, is we have, within the senior staff group, a board constantly horizon scanning on the constitutional change and feeding down into operational areas. So, specifically, for example, in relation to tax and welfare powers, where we have a bit of a sense about where they're going, we've put a bit of extra strength in, Convener. What we've not done is put speculative posts in, so we're trying to sort of proceed as we're going on. I'm very confident that the budget we're proposing for next year has got sufficient capacity in it to cope with the immediate demands, particularly around scrutinising the new fiscal regime and the emerging welfare powers. I think you make an important point around the presiding officer's commission. To reinforce Jackson Carlow's point, we just don't know where that is going to take us. So what we have done is put funding in to support the process of the commission, and accepting that it's due to report next summer. And again, to pick up the point Jackson made in his opening remarks in terms of next year's forecast, we'd have to revisit that. And depending on how radical and substantial the recommendations of that commission were, we'd obviously have to reflect that most likely in next year's budget and beyond.
Okay. One of the items which Jackson Carlow referred to himself in page 3 of the presiding officer's letter to us was the proposal for the 16-17 office budget amounting to £9.4 million, an increase of 1.3 or 15% on the approved budget for that area. Now, obviously, I recognise that a lot of that area is dependent on the decisions Parliament takes. And In these circumstances, the corporate body need to reflect what Parliament's decided. But I just wonder when the last time we had a review of commissioners and ombudsmen took place. I mean, to ordinary individuals and the public, seeing that number at 15% would, given the pressures we know are going to come in other areas of budget, might start to, you know, people raise their eyebrows. But so I just wonder when's the last time we had a review in that area, and is there any proposals to do a review in the near future?
I mean, I'll turn to Paul in a second. I accept the point that you make, Convener. I know that there has been a previous review, and Paul will be able to give the detail of that. Primarily, certainly, of the increase that we are anticipating in relation to this area, the vast majority of it this year is relating to the additional responsibilities that it has been determined that the Ombudsman will carry. But I think you make a wider point of interest, and Paul, would you like to...
There was a review a number of years ago. A previous corporate body was very interested in a sort of deeper rationalisation of the office holders. As a result of that, I think it's fair to say the reform which did occur was sort of somewhere between where the corporate body wanted to go and what was felt to be acceptable at the time. And that, for example, led to the creation of the Ethical Standards Commission, bringing together public appointments and standards. So there was some movement, and also off the back of that, an ongoing piece of work about trying to rationalise accommodation and shared services. But I think it certainly was the case, and if the Finance Committee were interested to encourage this, certainly the corporate body in the past has been very interested in exploring, though it would require obviously wider parliamentary agreement, whether there's any further could be done. So if that was something the Finance Committee wished us to look at, I'm pretty confident in saying the corporate body would be more than happy to take that on and perhaps come back to the Finance Committee with some further thoughts.
Okay, James.
Yeah, thank you, Convener, and good morning. I'm interested in the contingency. Some people looking at it from outside the Parliament might say, you know, why should we approve a budget that sets aside £1 million in contingency to give the proviso to dip into during the course of the year? I know, obviously, we've set a contingency in previous years. Can you maybe give some examples of how the contingency has been used previously that would give some reassurance that this is value for money budgeting?
Firstly, thank you, Mr. Kelly. What I would say is that I think there has been a greater reliance on providing for contingency within the budget in previous years, and this year's figure actually, to my mind, represents something less of a contingency than we've perhaps previously provided. And I would say, looking at it and at the challenges that are coming forward, whilst the corporate body has sought at all times to bring forward a budget which is prudent and cautious, the relying less or making less of a provision within the contingency is beginning to present its own challenges. And I do think going forward, we have to be mindful that the headroom that is left within that contingency in each year is beginning to shrink. And I'm not sure that in the long run that will be adequate. That the contingency fund is obviously used across a whole range of different areas. I think probably, Derek, can you give examples of previous use of it?
Yeah, certainly. I mean, in the current year, it's been used for things like the PO's Commission on Parliamentary Reform. So that's a project that's come forward in the current year that wasn't envisaged in last year's budget submission. We have used it to support projects in other areas, particularly around the sort of the service yard project, which we took forward last year. We were able to find funding from that from the contingency. In terms of next year's budget bid, we've got quite a lot of potential costs which we've deliberately not budgeted in our line budgets on the property side and IT side, where we're re-tendering two very major contracts, and we expect we'll probably have double running costs on those when the new contracts come in, but we've deliberately not budgeted for those double running costs in the line budgets, and I said we'll take that out of contingency. So it's to meet things where we don't have definite, you know, figures to go with for next year's budget.
Okay, just on the projected income figures, I note that these are both for the budget bid and the forecast, these are down on last year's income figures. Why is that the case, given that there's been quite a focus, quite rightly, from the Parliament in recent years on increasing commercial activities and obviously increasing income from that?
There has been an increase in commercial activity. I don't think we should overstate the benefit that actually accrues from that. The commercial events pilot is still very much one that is finding its feet. It hasn't as yet made a profit or a meaningful contribution to the cost of the Parliament. The corporate body's decided to extend it a bit further because there is now some repeat business coming and there's the opportunity for it to contribute, but it will be at modest levels. The shop as well brings in additional income. We still subsidise the catering facilities, as you will be aware. So yes, there has been an effort to do that, but the contingency has to cover quite a wide range of additional things that arise. What we've done this year is to reduce the additional element that exists within the contingency, but I'm concerned it will start to come under some potential pressure if any really significant unforeseen events were to arise.
But specifically, can you give an explanation as to why last year we had income of £262,000 and this year we're budgeting for income of £255,000, which is a drop in income?
Yeah, I mean, I could probably cover that. The income is effectively the turnover from the shop, and it's very much related to visitor numbers coming to the building. And we have seen a general trend of reductions in visitor numbers over 4 or 5 years. In terms of the budget for this year of 262, our current year outturn forecast is that it will come down to the level that's in the next year's budget bid. So we're seeing just a reduction in visitor numbers.
I think it's worth pointing out that visitor numbers and the income from the shop can sometimes be determined by events that are being held. You'll recall the tapestry event that was in the entrance lobby, which generated huge visitor numbers and a very significant spike in the turnover of the shop in that year. So the Parliament is obviously looking to see what other events can be held which would bring significant additional traffic into the Parliament that might then enhance the revenue within the shop. But it is obviously dependent upon visitor numbers, and that led to a significant increase.
Okay.
Adam.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning. I wanted to ask about the Ombudsman. So the Ombudsman's budget is to go up by £1 million from £3.5 million to £4.5 million. That isn't the 15% increase, that's a 30% increase. I understand that the Ombudsman's statutory functions have increased because of the Scottish Welfare Fund, but have they increased by, has the workload of the Ombudsman increased by 30%?
Well, I mean, the total for the Ombudsman represents an increase of 1 million. If the 1 million for the new functions was actually removed, the increase is only 3% on the 2016-2017 budgets. And the majority of that is for staff costs due to the two-year pay award, which was agreed last year, the second year of that, and the Healthy Living Initiative and staff progression elements that were incorporated within that award. So that is where the majority of the increase actually comes from, over and above the additional responsibilities.
Yeah, but the additional responsibilities aren't that significant, are they? The additional responsibilities are to hear complaints arising out of the administration of the Scottish Welfare Fund, which is a fund of about £35 million. And is the suggestion that that increase in statutory functions is leading to a 30% increase in the business of the Ombudsman? And if it isn't, then what's the justification for increasing the budget of the Ombudsman by that, not eye-catching, but eye-watering figure?
Well, the increase will have been directly calculated as a result of the assessment of the additional responsibilities that the Ombudsman now has, and the way in which they will have to be properly met, meeting the legislative requirements that arise. Paul?
Yeah, I mean, what I would say, this represents a direct transfer of responsibilities from the government, if you like, to the Ombudsman, and it was negotiated on that basis. So they would be expect to make a commensurate saving in their expenditure, so that this was really a negotiation which took place principally between the Ombudsman and the government. And we were content on the basis that, you know, the transfer was agreed at that level.
So we can expect to see in the government's budget next week a saving of £1 million that is related to this increase, can we?
You might wish to raise that evidence. But I mean, the serious point, it was a direct transfer, and I think there's some other functions as well as the welfare fund as part of that. So that's what we thought that was an acceptable baseline transfer.
Yeah.
And if the government was content to accept that, we felt that that was reasonable from our point of view. What we will do, if this gives you some assurance, we'll obviously monitor, now that we've accepted responsibility for that as the overall funders of the Ombudsman, we will monitor that along with the Ombudsman. And that turns out to be, more than is required, then obviously that's something we would report back.
And I think it would be helpful to know what the increase in workload has been of the Ombudsman as a result of the transfer of these powers, and what kind of additional staff resources the Ombudsman has felt necessary to appoint to cope with that increased demand, so then we can assess where this £1 million is going.
I'd be very happy if Jackson is that we would drop you a note on that with a bit more detail. That would be helpful.
Thank you.
Well, it was a supplementary or no? In that case, Murdo.
Thank you. I've got two separate questions I'd like to ask. First is around the question of contingency and legal costs. Can you remind us what the total legal bill was in relation to the court action for the removal of the illegal encampment on Parliament land, and what are the realistic prospects of any of that money being recovered?
My recollection was about 100,000, but Paul again has got the actual figure in relation to that.
Yeah, I mean, in terms of contingency, there's no separate contingency for legal issues. I mean, just really to develop a little bit in response to Mr. Kelly's point. I mean, the contingency is broadly a sum, usually around £500,000 for pure emergencies, and that could be, for example, substantial court. Of course, it's the sort of thing that just can't be predicted. And others, which I think Derek Crowell answered, where we have an idea about what's coming, but we don't want to firmly budget for it. And so that side of it. And any unexpected legal costs would come out of that. So there's no separate cost. It's not over yet, of course. In fact, I think next week we'll be back in court. Looking at two things. One is pursuing the matter of costs, which I'll come to in a minute, and the other is because the Indicambas are seeking leave to appeal to the Supreme Court, and that obviously we have to address that. The total cost to date, I think, are just over £100,000. And in terms of realistic prospect, well, the first hurdle we have to overcome is to persuade the court to allow us to seek the recovery of some of those expenses, and that is a matter, of course, for the court, but we are applying for that. Thereafter, if the court does grant that, and of course that is entirely a matter for the court, they will likely grant a proportion of that. That would be normally what would be expected. And we will just have to take a judgment, and one of my jobs in advising the corporate body is how realistic it is. And of course, what one must never do is incur more money pursuing costs than might likely be recovered. But, it is public money, and I think we have a responsibility at least to look seriously at whether that is possible, and that would be very much my starting point, and ultimately for the corporate body and myself to judge what is right. And I guess when we're up in front of you this time next year, we'd be able to give you an update as to how that has actually gone.
Okay, thank you for that. That was a very helpful response. Just going back to what you said about the Supreme Court, presumably if there were to be an appeal to the Supreme Court, the legal cost to the corporate body could be very substantial if that case were to be pursued, and presumably that would be covered by the contingency that you've built into the accounts.
That's a good example of the sort of cost we would have to cover from that sort of budget, yeah.
Okay, thank you. My second question is on an unrelated matter, and is an issue that I've raised on previous occasions in relation to the remuneration of committee advisers. And I felt for a long time that committee advisers in this Parliament are not sufficiently remunerated for the work they do. I know there's been an increase in the daily rate fairly recently, I think, but the daily rate now for committee advisers is not much more than what was my hourly rate when I was in the legal profession, and that was 15 years ago. And it seems to me that the rate we're paying committee advisers at is not a proper reflection of their contribution. Is that something the corporate body will consider?
I'm happy to again ask Paul to answer that and to note the point you make.
Yes, I mean, obviously not on your hourly rate as you were paid. It's an issue that's been raised over the years, and I think it's a fair point. I mean, we have to balance two things. One, of course, is, it's public money, so my approach always is to get the most I can for the least amount of money. And there's a sort of supply and demand in there, and I think there is still a substantial, if you're looking at it from a pure market point of view, there's a still a substantial supply of very high caliber advisors willing to work for that rate. And so on that grounds, it's quite hard to justify unilaterally increasing the rate. We did, as you say, increase it modestly, I think from 137 to 150 a day. And I do accept that is modest in all the other things. I think, though, one of the benefits advisors get from it is, you know, the fact of having advised a parliamentary committee is a positive thing in terms of their CV, and that adds some value to it. So at the moment, I think the corporate body would be reluctant to increase that, but it is something we keep under review. And if it were certainly the case that committees of the Parliament who are there to serve felt that, for example, we were not getting the breadth and calibre of people we want, then I know the corporate body would look at that. But at the moment, I think, given that we are able to secure good advice for that price, it's hard, I think, to justify increasing the day rate.
Okay. Thank you.
Patrick. Thanks very much. Good morning. Obviously, one of the controversial issues within the SBCB's budget is MSP pay. I'm more interested in the wider pay policy for other people working for the Scottish Parliament. Does that follow automatically in lockstep with Scottish Government pay policy? And if there was to be a change in Scottish Government pay policy, how quickly would the Scottish Parliament adapt to fall in line with it? If, for example, there was a change mid-year, would that come out of contingencies, or are these things built into the budget?
Well, 2 points. Firstly, yes, this is the first time that the budget submission has been the method by which MSP pay has been confirmed. And as you know, we decoupled ourselves from Westminster, which meant that, you know, the comparable pay rate previously was 87.5% of that which Westminster MPs earned, and in the budget that we're looking at, the current year, it's 81%. So it has represented a reduction, but yes, it'll be 1.8% for MSPs applied from April next year. The staff pay within the campus of the Parliament is the subject of a separate negotiation with the trade unions and the staff bodies. A two-year agreement was arrived at last year. It isn't, as I understand it, coupled to anything that relates to the Scottish Government. It is a negotiation which we enter into quite separately. The two-year arrangement was arrived at, and there are links, as I mentioned in my opening remarks, in relation to the Healthy Living Fund and the other aspects that were peripheral to that agreement, which are incorporated within this year's budget too. I imagine at the end of the two-year period, a separate negotiation will be commenced again in relation to the next pay period thereafter. But it isn't, to answer your question, directly related to the employment pay within the Scottish Government.
So our non-MSP staff, people working directly for the Parliament, are they enjoying a 1.8% increase as well?
I can answer.
Well, my answer to that would be...
About the same, actually.
Yes, about the same.
Across the board?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
Neil, just wanted to ask you about more than the apprenticeship programme. I note that in 2017-18, you're proposing £107,000 for the modern apprenticeship programme aimed at young people aged 16 to 24. That's down 20,000 or 21,000 from 128,000 in 16-17. Just wanted to ask why that particular reduction is proposed, and is that something through other savings or underspend that could be looked at for additional expenditure?
Yep, that's a reasonable question. Again, I think I'll invite Paul to answer that one.
Yeah, we set out, obviously something we're very proud of, actually, our modern apprenticeship programme. So we set out to employ 20 modern apprentices, and the original plan was to appoint them in two tranches of 10. The first in 2017 and second in 2015, sorry, and the second tranche in 2017. But actually, the quality was just phenomenally high, and I agreed that we would actually appoint 13 apprentices in the first tranche. So, and they're mostly delighted to say the vast majority of those have now actually secured their qualifications and their SVQs and are now very much in the job pool here in the Parliament, which is where we hope to keep them. And then in next year, the tranche of seven. So in a sense, the reduction just reflects the fact that we took most of a disproportionate amount of that funding up front, and that's the funding for the apprenticeship programme itself. And then separately, of course, and Derek could maybe say more on this if you wished, about then how the idea is that they then become available to take up jobs in the Parliament, and then they, in a sense, are not funded through the apprenticeship programme, but just become as part of the normal staff group. So that's all it reflects. In terms of the numbers, my current thinking is that we stick to the seven, so that gives us the total of 20, but clearly we feel it's been a hugely successful programme, and I would be very hopeful that with the agreement of the corporate body, after the next tranche, we look again so it becomes a rolling programme going forward, which will be partly dependent on what we can afford, but actually as much as anything determined by what I think the needs of the organisation are. Although we don't guarantee jobs, it's very much my hope that anyone who succeeds in their apprenticeship is given the opportunity to work long term in the Parliament, and so that you've got to sort of keep those two things in mind.
Yep. Willie?
Thanks very much. Convener, I wonder if I could ask about our investment plans for IT and bringing the Parliament more into the digital age. There's been a substantial investment so far that I'd like to recognise and welcome in terms of technology and software for members and staff alike. But I was thinking more about the Parliament's website and whether we could make that more multimedia friendly or digital friendly. For example, the official report is a fantastic resource, but it's all text. It tends to be very heavily text-oriented. And is there any intention to perhaps introduce a multimedia element to that so we can see video clips of contributions, perhaps? It helps the general population, but it also helps people with sight impairments as well, I think, and that would be a good thing to do.
Yeah. I mean, there has been an astonishing increase in digital application and usage across the whole Parliament. I was quite astonished at the reduction now in paper that the Parliament has achieved. It's way beyond the expected initial reduction target. And that, of course, just reflects the fact that there are so many different digital devices and platforms being used across the Parliament in so many different ways. The budget for next year does include a significant increase in the IT support staff and placements, given all of the different platforms that need to be maintained and managed going forward. There are also, though, some expenditures that we have deferred in order to maintain the overall budget level, and some of those, I think, do touch upon some of the areas that you've identified. As was explained to me, we won't just yet be able to enter in Willie Coffey and have all your greatest hits come up for the world to see at the press of a button, even if that is our ultimate objective. So there are some additional ways in which we do need to continue to look and modernise, but we're having to phase these as carefully as we can, given some of the immediate pressures we have to ensure that we are maintaining the immediate IT estate, which, of course, you will know there's a lot of change on a rolling basis with members being introduced to new equipment.
The only thing I would add to that is Sir Jackson's right, we have got a project in mind to link pictures and text, but that is one of those ones that's held. And if the money becomes available, we might look at that again. But we do have money, however, firmly set aside to redevelop the website, because we're conscious it's been quite some time since it was upgraded. And again, I know you've taken a long-term interest in this. I'd be more than happy to give you, or did the whole committee, a more detailed note on that. But that's firmly in the plans. And as Jackson said, we do have the idea in mind to link pictures and text, but that's probably going to have to sit and wait for money to come available. Probably not this year, but it might be next year.
But would there be any plans to engage with the public about what they want from the Parliament's website so that they can feed into what they would expect to see and hope to have in terms of
I think that's a really helpful idea. I mean, what I'll do, if it's okay with you, is I'll take that back to Alan Balhari, our head of BIT, that specific point, and more than happy to let you have a note. But yeah, getting some kind of user feedback would seem to me a critical point in designing it going forward.
I can also say, just since I also sit in the Scottish Parliamentary Reform Commission, that the ways in which the public can access and involve themselves in the Parliament through things like the website are one of the things that are being discussed and considered there too.
Good. Thank you.
Dean Lockhart.
Yes, thank you. Good morning. It's a supplemental question on IT. Schedule 3 sets out a budget of approximately £2 million for next year for IT expenditure. What we're hearing from other businesses is that IT costs are substantially increasing because partly because of the depreciation of sterling. IT costs, hardware and software, tends to be denominated in US dollars. Is this something you're experiencing in terms of increasing cost for IT systems, and will you review this budget over the course of the next 12, 18 months to ensure that any increased cost for ITs will be budgeted into this number?
Well, I'm sure the answer to the second point is yes, of course we will. This does actually represent a considerable additional increase in the increment of people who will be employed within the estate on IT maintenance, development and future digital development and creation. It is actually quite significant. I thought members, a bit like me, some of the titles can appear to be, to lay people, not always altogether clear, but I have myself sought to have a proper explanation of what all of the different people will be doing. And a lot of it is linked to all of the different platforms that we have. As to the actual acquisition costs of IT, if we've noticed any particular increase in them, I don't know, Derek, have we?
It's not come through yet. I mean, I think a lot of the IT budget for the next sort of year or so is revenue costs, it's staff costs, so it's stuff that is UK-based rather than buying equipment.
Good. Thank you.
Yeah, thanks, convener. First of all, I have a couple of substantial questions, but just a couple of points before I go into that. Just to thank you for your answer on the advisors, I would struggle to see why we would spend more money on that if we didn't have to. So I think what you said makes a lot of sense. And also to echo what the convener said on commissioners in particular, I heard your answer on ombudsman. But if you look at the commissioners, a number of those are getting increases of 5, 6, 7%, which does look substantial given where we are. Just for the record, in terms of the substantial, clearly the biggest issue, the biggest spend item is staff. And just to say, as a new member to the Parliament, I've been delighted by the level of support that the staff provide, and that's very important to recognise. I note that you said back between 2010-11 there was a review carried out, and that resulted in a 10% real-term saving. So I'm assuming that was a review of the processes, business re-engineering type activity. So I suppose the question is there a plan to do that again? Because clearly there's always more we can do, and that was a number of years ago. And secondly, the output of that work, is that available for us to review, just to understand what was done at that time and what processes were re-engineered to what effect?
I think Paul will come in as well, but I think in terms of the general circumstances that obtained at the time, there was a feeling that the Scottish Parliament had itself to look carefully at its employment overhead, and there was a reduction of 68 employees in the year 2010-11, which was a significant fall. It's gradually started to increase again, and a number of the additional posts that we're looking at in the next year relate, for example, to the Scottish Government and the new register of lobbyists, which the Parliament has to put in place. Undertaking a full and comprehensive review on a regular basis, obviously, is not something you would do. It's something that we would do from time to time. And there would have to be, I think, a clear sense of what the outcome of that was going to be in terms of any major restructuring of the Parliament. But the answer is yes. I mean, the corporate body are always, particularly where new posts are beginning to emerge, keen to ensure that they are justified and that we are looking to see whether any of the other posts are posts which are always required, and I know Paul does that on an ongoing basis.
Yeah, I mean, I think that's where I would be at the moment. We had to, you'll recall, it was a crisis really following the 2008-09 position, and I felt, and the corporate body felt at the time, that we had to do something really quite fundamental to get the headcount and costs down. And there's nothing published on that, but I'm more than happy to see what I can do. So, for example, I did a pretty fundamental review of the senior management of the organisation at the time, and if I'm more than happy to drop you a bit more on that. But there's always a cost to these things. I mean, an organisation that's subject to fundamental reviews, there's a certain amount of stress and anxiety in the system. And so you have to weigh the two things up. And so at the moment, I think, to really reinforce the point Jackson has just made, I think it's about ongoing, constantly striving for improvement, always looking for innovation. You know, and I think that, I think, is the model we're in now, and I think we'll go forward. Clearly, you know as well as I do, we live in uncertain times, and whether to be a further substantial change in our circumstances. And I felt it required a more radical review, then we would do the same again. But for the moment, I think it's about just looking continuously to improve. But if there's anything I've got from the 2008-09 period, I'd be more than happy to share that with you.
Yeah, I mean, it's always a good idea to fix the roof when it's not raining. I would encourage you to strive for innovation where you can. And the other question was around about, I mean, the other big chunk that's in there, which isn't parcelled out, is the $7 million running costs. Is there any kind of breakdown? It says it's for services that you're buying in, etc. Is there any kind of rough overview as to what is in that?
Yeah, Derek might go into the detail of that.
Yeah, it's a lot of outsourced contracts. It covers things like our IT support contract. It covers all the sort of general advisors, porters, catering, cleaning. I mean, there's a lot of stuff within there that is typically stuff that we buy in. Telephony goes through there. The IT support contract is the largest one.
It might just be just a kind of next level down breakdown of the $7 million might be helpful.
Yeah.
Thanks very much.
What I would say on that is that obviously we have a forward look through our procurement strategy looking at these big contracts. Some of them, where we can, we work with. We can often sometimes share government negotiated contracts, which represent good value for money. Where we don't think that's appropriate, we take a quite strategic look at how to bundle contracts, how to get the best value. And I think over time, you know, it's often been a source of savings. Bearing in mind, quality is important as well for the reasons we say. But again, if you'd like a bit more detail on that, I'm sure we can let you have a note.
Thank you.
Other one final question, just a very overview question. I know, I'm conscious of the fact we've got quite a lot of new members on the committee. I'm not sure, they may do, but I'm not sure everyone would be entirely aware of how you requisition your resources in terms of how it works in the Scottish Bloc. Just, so if you could just give us a quick resume of how that works, that would be very useful, I think.
That one's for you.
Yes, so there's an important constitutional point underlying, I think, the position, which is that the Parliament has, I think, the privilege and the responsibility that it makes its budget bid separate and before the government, which is, in a sense, why we're here before you today. And I think that recognises the fact that the Parliament, in its funding, must be entirely independent from government. Not that there's ever been any issue with the government, but I think it's constitutionally very important. I think in case any of the colleagues on the table are wondering why we are here with our budget ahead of the government, it is for that very reason. So whatever budget is ultimately agreed upon, proposed by the corporate body and hopefully agreed by the Finance Committee, that is netted off the Scottish Bloc, and what is left in a sense is what is available to the government. So that's I think the important constitutional position which is enshrined in this Parliament, and I hope that's helpful explanation to the members of the committee.
I think it probably is. Some members weren't entirely sure of it. Maybe it was an opening question rather than an ending question, but
no.
I've got it on the record anyway. Can I thank the witnesses for coming along and giving us evidence today? And obviously, you've committed to giving us a number of pieces of additional information, and we look forward to receiving that. Given that we're a wee bit ahead of times here, colleagues, and our next witnesses are not due until 10:30, can I suggest that we just amend the agenda slightly and move now into private and then come back into open session at 10:30 for our witnesses. And in that case, I now move this session of the committee into private and at the same time thank the witnesses again for coming along this morning. Thank you. Okay, colleagues, we reconvene. The third item on today's agenda is to take evidence from the EY Item Club on the Scottish growth estimates, and I welcome to the meeting Mark Gregory, who's the Chief Economist, Dewey Adams, the Senior Economic Advisor, and Duncan Whitehead, the Lead Economic Advisory for Scotland. Welcome, gentlemen. Members have received copies of the growth forecasts along with a spice paper on growth and forecasting. But before we move to questions from the committee, can I invite Mr. Gregory, Mr. Adams, to provide a brief overview of their work in this area? And I can give you up to 5 minutes if you want to take that in terms of where you are.
So I'll go very quickly. So thank you for asking us to come in. I mean, the reason EY sponsors economic research is partly for our own interest in our business, but also to try and help facilitate the debate between business and government on economic issues. So opportunities like this are very important to us. Just, I mean, literally the one-minute version of ITEM stands for Independent Treasury Economic Model. When Margaret Thatcher was Prime Minister, she made public sector information available to the private sector to use. A set of businesses came together and formed ITEM to produce their own economic forecast, uses the Treasury model. EY has been the sponsor for about the last 25 or so years. It used to be Midland Bank. And so the process is we have the Treasury model, now partly the OBR model, which we update. We then have a set of businesses who we ask for input on what they're seeing in the economy. EY provides data. And then Professor Peter Spencer, who's the senior advisor to the Item Club at the UK level, makes the final call on what assumptions we use in that model. So that produces a UK forecast. We then, for a decade now, have produced a Scottish forecast. We also produce an Irish economic eye. And for the last 18 months, we've produced a UK regions and cities forecast, which includes six or seven Scottish cities and all the major cities in the UK. So I think as we get into the discussion, if we want to sort of put Scotland into context, we can draw on some of that analysis as well. And that's really my role, is to try and provide the UK framework around this. Dougie and Duncan are much closer to the Scottish data, and I'll now let Dougie talk you a bit more about what goes on there.
Yeah, it might be worth outlining how we do it and what we do. The current approach is to take the UK results, drive them through an industrial sector model of the UK, and then use that in the industry forecasts at a UK level to create employment forecasts at the Scottish level that we then move back up using assumptions about productivity trends in different industries to the output figures and the GDP figures that you see. So it's very much about industry disaggregated forecasts, aggregate GDP, consumers' expenditure. We don't look at the moment, we don't look at public revenues or public spending. That's something that we feel we're going to have to develop over the longer term to meet the needs in Scotland, but it's not something that we do at the moment. In terms of our latest forecast, it's downbeat from where it was 6 months ago. A number of reasons for that. Global trade growth has continued to disappoint at a global level. There are new uncertainties around both domestically from Brexit and across the Atlantic in terms of how trade policy will evolve from here. The Scottish consumer has been very ebullient through this year, but the savings ratio in Scotland is now, you almost say, alarmingly low. And so there's not much puff left in the consumer for next year, especially as employment levels and activity rates have been, well, employment's flat and employment activity rates have been falling. Therefore, we're coming up with a forecast of about 0.4% for GDP growth next year. Although I must stress that in terms of economic forecasting, the headlines are always about an individual number. In reality, we're talking about directions of travel, and there's lots of uncertainties around how the details fall out. Perhaps economic models and forecasting are better as a basis for scenario work than for looking at individual point numbers.
That's probably a useful place. Thank you very much. That's a useful overview, particularly from the top level and how you brought it down into Scotland. So I'm grateful for that. That uncertainty issue is one of the issues I wanted to raise at the beginning, and the point forecasts, etc. In terms of your forecasts and the point estimates you make, are there any particular economic factors or drivers that your forecasts are particularly sensitive to?
There's a number. In the short term, one of the biggest uncertainties is around business investment. I think most economists feel that the uncertainty around Brexit is likely to put a stall on investment spending until there's more clarity. But the latest figures we've got for the UK for the third quarter are not that bad. But maybe that's driven by decisions that were taken before the referendum vote. So investment spending by businesses is a big uncertainty at the moment.
Just on that, I think the latest OBR forecast, which came out in the autumn statement for the UK, has investment growing at sort of over 2%, whereas ITEM thinks at the UK level it'll probably fall by 1% next year. So there's that range there. And I think if you look across the forecast, we see that variability sort of at the UK level and then obviously at the Scotland level as well.
And it's particularly relevant at the moment because if you go back 9 months, say, to forecast, people were looking for business investment to be one of the most buoyant elements of demand in the economy. So that I think that's the big short-term uncertainty over business investment. Slightly longer term, there's the uncertainty around trade. You know, are we in the single market? Are we in the customs union? What would trading under WTO rules and regulations look like? That's maybe not going to hit trade over the next 18 months, 2 years, although it may affect companies in terms of the amount of effort they put into developing particular markets and so on. But trade issues are perhaps you're looking out into 2018 and beyond for big uncertainties across the board. And then longer term, I think there are issues which are particularly important for Scotland on labour supply. Scotland's working age population is going to be falling, I don't know, about 0.2, 0.3% per annum as we get towards the end of this decade. We know a number of sectors in Scotland are very reliant on migrant labour. Food processing, I believe, up to 30% of the workforce is from the European Union. So labour supply is an issue for Scotland longer term. And another uncertainty, I guess, which kind of loops back to the business investment, is on foreign direct investment, on how attitudes to investing in Scotland or the rest of the UK change because of Brexit. They are all very big uncertainties and not uncertainties that economic models are any good at really sorting out. The economic models are fine if you take some assumptions about how those uncertainties will play out. You can then develop scenarios. But if you don't know how those issues are going to play out, then it's pretty difficult to make confident forecasts.
So, really, I think the message that I'm taking from that is no matter who the forecaster is at this stage, because of the level of uncertainties that exist as you've described them, that actually there's a health warning on all forecasts at this stage because of that level of uncertainty, and it's only trends that we can be looking at. And no matter who's producing that forecast, everyone's facing that same uncertainty and trying to make these out, you know, trying to define what will happen.
Yeah. If you look at the Bank of England's forecast, they provide what they call a fan chart, which is the range of the probability of the outcomes, and those ranges are wider at the moment than they've been for as long as they've been producing them effectively for exactly that reason. So it's always difficult. It's actually more difficult at the current time than probably in anyone's memory, I would say.
And you know, businesses are facing those exact same questions in their own scenario planning. So it helps illustrate the difficulties of making investment decisions in this type of environment, which is, we think throws sand into the wheel. It doesn't mean business investment stops; it just puts sand in the wheels.
How difficult does that make the Scottish Government's job in trying to set its budget next week?
I'll just add something on the business investment. As Dougie says, it's highly volatile, and it is encouraging to see that actually the Scottish Government is actually producing statistics on business investment for Scotland, and that's been actually a new bit of evidence that's come to the fore. at the end of the day, many of the macro models basically are a function of the quality of the data goes into it and the thoughtfulness of the assumptions made. So you bringing that evidence to bear does actually help enrich the discussions around what the uncertainties are and what the fan might be.
Yeah, I mean, you know, but I think you are right. The I think it was the autumn statement last year where the commentators described the OBR as finding £27 billion behind the sofa for UK public finances, which they then lost, and £35 billion more by the time of the budget in March. So the ranges of spread are very significant at a time when it is so volatile. So, and particularly in Scotland, where as you get more and more control of the sort of fiscal agenda, you haven't got the kind of base to look back on, so I would say it probably does make it even harder in that context than somewhere where the system's been established for a longer period of time.
Okay, James. James.
All right, sorry. Thank you, convener. I wanted to ask some questions around employment. Interested in your analysis showing differential rates in terms of men and women, particularly pinpointing the fact that there's been a drop since 2015 in the number of women in the workforce of 35,000. Just interested in an explanation around that and how that is likely to pan out going forward.
It's a mystery because if you think about the adverse forces that hit the Scottish economy in the last 18 months, oil price shock, a lot of oil-related jobs you think of being more male-oriented. You think about the rise in the women's pension age. Again, you would think that would actually encourage women to hang into the labour market for longer. And yet, the data on employment activity rate shows that women are to some extent exiting the labour market. That said, female employment is still at an aggregate level very high compared with past history. But why we would have this very sharp rise up to 2015 and then quite a sharp fall off is a big mystery at the moment. Could be a quirk in the statistics, I don't know, but I can't offer you a reason why I think it's happening.
Is there anything to show that it's more sharp in certain sectors?
I haven't got the data on that. It's an interesting question. Perhaps local authority employment might be an issue, but I haven't got any data to show that.
Okay. Just looking at your table in Annex 2 in terms of, you know, forecasting employment growth going forward by sector. In terms of education, it looks in terms of the bar chart that that's due to drop between 2016 and 19 by around 5%. Can you just confirm what the figure is and say how that would manifest itself?
We've got education employment dropping from 100,000 in 2015 down to 197,000 in 2017. That's the public sector numbers in this for employment are driven by what we see happening at a UK level and are not modulated for what you might say were specific Scottish policies. So this has been driven by what we see happening to spending levels at a UK level, driving the Scottish forecast.
But would you accept that if the forecast is that we're going to see a drop in employment in the education sector, that is linked to the kind of decline that you're seeing in growth and also presents a challenge in respect to yesterday's PISA statistics? If we want to see improvements in areas, for example, like science and maths, if we're reducing employment in those areas, then there's clearly a challenge there.
Yeah, there's no doubt that, you know, linking back to initial remarks on productivity, that education is something that, you know, is key not just for for Scotland, but for every Western country. If we're going to drive productivity growth that drives living standards, I wouldn't make too much of those numbers, except that they're portraying what the profile of spending at an aggregate UK level looks like on education.
No, but it is. It's implicit in the UK government's spending programme that public services will improve productivity, that effectively you will be doing more with less, and I think that's one manifestation of that. So clearly, you know, that's the challenge that's set out there, and if that productivity isn't realised, then, you know, you potentially do have the challenges you talk about there.
Okay, thank you.
Murdo.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning. I wonder if I could ask about your forecasts for GDP for 2016. Am I right in saying that you've downgraded your forecast for 2016 three times? So at the start of the year, you were forecasting 2.3% growth. You then revised that down to 1.8, then to 1.2, and now you're at 0.7. Is that right?
Yes, I think that's broadly correct. And, you know, there's a whole range of influences there. The world economy has not grown as robustly as everybody expected, or most forecasters expected 18 months or so ago. Trade growth has been lower, and that obviously has an effect through to the UK economy and through to the Scottish economy. The lingering effects of the oil price fall on Scotland have perhaps been more severe than we expected. Scotland's not done well in terms of its trade performance. Exports to the rest of the UK have been growing much more slowly than the rest of UK GDP. That's probably down to composition effects as much as anything, but we've not got much bang from that buck. So that's all been an influence, and then there's the uncertainties thrown up by Brexit.
I'll just make the comment, though, it's quite a substantial revision since the start of the year. Mm-hmm. You know, if you're forecasters, we would hope you'd be able to forecast what was coming, and suggest that you've rather missed what was likely to be coming down the track. You had to make such substantial revisions downwards. I note you're now forecasting GDP growth for 2016 as a whole at 0.7%, but have we not already exceeded that in the first three quarters?
Well, we've only got data for the first two quarters, and one of the issues at looking at GDP is whether you look at the annual average against the annual average, or you look at the profile as it runs through the year. So perhaps GDP in the fourth quarter of this year against GDP in the fourth quarter of last year. And what we've seen in Scotland was, in the data we've got to the second quarter, that the economy was gaining some momentum in the second quarter. We don't have any particular evidence for the third quarter yet, except some employment data that looks pretty flat. There may be a bit of a the headline figures are annual average against annual average rather than final quarter against final quarter. So no, we haven't exceeded the.
There's a comment on page 13 of your brief that GDP in Scotland grew by 0.7% in the year to the end of June. So what you seem to be saying is that for the third and fourth quarters of 2016, there'll be virtually zero growth.
No, we had a good quarter of growth in the fourth quarter of last year. So that figure is Q2 2016 over Q2 2015, which is not the same as the annual average level against the annual average level.
But you're expecting very little growth to come through.
Yes.
In the second part of 2016.
Yes.
Okay. I mean, compared to other forecasters, you do seem to have a very pessimistic outlook. Why are you more pessimistic than others?
I don't think we are particularly more pessimistic than others looking at the Scottish economy, and I guess at the item level we're more pessimistic than the OBR, but we're not miles away from what most private sector forecasters are saying. So I don't think we are particularly pessimistic, and unfortunately over the last 7 or 8 years, pessimism has tended to be the the side to err on.
I think at the UK level, from memory, in January we were forecasting 2.7% GDP growth for the UK. We produced what I think was the first forecast after the referendum, where we were at 1.9%, which was actually at that point above consensus as people brought those forecasts out. We're still at 1.9 for 2016 for the UK as a whole. I would guess, looking at the data, we're going to be 1.9 to 2%. I think we'll be pretty close to that. So, yes, we're below OBR, but I think we're pretty in the range in terms of the UK level. I think we have got some specific Scottish factors that are there. You know, one thing we've certainly seen over the last year is I think we and others underestimated how the knock-on effects of oil. So you can pick the oil sector, but actually I think its impact on professional services and other sectors has been starker than we realised. And I think we're still trying to figure out what the right adjustment there is on that.
Okay. Thank you.
I've got your submission here, and I'm on the page Brexit and Scottish exports. So you say in here that the HMRC data set of regional trade statistics, a smaller proportion of Scottish manufactured exports went to the EU than was the case for the UK, and their respective figures for that were 41% for Scotland compared to 48% for the UK as a whole. And I'm quite interested in these type of figures because I'm on the Economy Committee as well, and we've had a number of expert witnesses that have been coming in over the last while, and the quality, shall we say, or the availability of data that's specific to Scotland has been raised, you know, time and time again. So I'm interested in your view on that. And also, there's been a suggestion of what's called the Rotterdam effect. I don't know if you're familiar with that term. So in that case, as it applies to the UK, exports coming from Scotland might go to the UK, be counted as being exported into the UK, but actually be en route elsewhere. And I'd be interested to hear what your comments would be on that.
Why don't I just start with exports and hand over to you for Scotland? So I think the quality of export data is a concern for everyone. And, you know, the ONS yesterday revised all of their trade data, and I think from memory it took 0.5% off the current account deficit in June compared to what it was previously. But ONS's trade statistics have actually not been quality assured in recent times because they've been so worried about them. So there's an overall collection issue. I think secondly, there's then a question of services versus goods, and we can physically identify goods to some extent. Services trade data is very problematic, and I think, you know, the OECD's done some work, but it's really not very good. And so when you then try and disaggregate that to regions or the devolved administrations, you're into those problems. So I think we have some knowledge of goods, not of services, but then, as you rightly say, those goods, many of them do go to Rotterdam, and so we don't quite know where they go to in the past. So I think there is, you know, a whole set of overall challenges of export data that are going to be particularly problematic as we move forward and, you know, are negotiating on trade where we may not even know really what our starting base is as a country, and then for Scotland specifically, Dougie.
Yeah, I think the data from the HMRC database, which is very detailed, but, you know, I think it just gives us one indicator in trying to work our way through what is, as you've described, a pretty murky picture. And what we've just simply tried to do here is try to line up where Scotland has a high proportion of exports that appear to go to the EU with, you know, potential tariffs that could be faced if we ended up in a WTO type of Brexit. So there's a lot of straw men being built in there, but it's one of the few kind of, I hesitate to say concrete bits of evidence, it's one of the few bits of circumstantial evidence that we've got on Scottish exports to the EU by sector. And even within sectors, when you drill down to an even more disaggregated level, the types of tariffs that could be faced by goods that come into the same aggregate sector, say like chemicals, could be quite different.
We're talking about exports, but actually imports are going to be a very important feature of the Brexit debate. You know, if we take Jaguar Land Rover, for example, I would imagine they run a trade deficit with Europe. They get a lot of their supplies from Europe, but they run a surplus with China because that's one of their major export markets. So when we're really trying to understand the sensitivities in trade, we've got to understand supply chains, and actually the import side is at least as important. And I think, you know, there are a set of challenges there as well in really trying to unpick that. So it is, it's going to be a really challenging area, I think.
Okay, thank you.
If that's a murky area, I think that was the description, what do we need to do as a country to sort that? Because that's obviously going to be hugely important for the future in terms of understanding what's going on in either the UK or the Scottish economy. What needs to be done? What do governments, organisations need to do to get this sorted?
I think we've got statistical systems that are really quite good for industrial economies, and it's easy to measure the number of pounds of smoked salmon we produce or whatever. When it comes to services, we've got bigger problems. It's got a lot more difficult because of the way supply chains now work around the world to measure what's going on where. And then there's the trade-off that's always there between the thirst for better data that would allow you to understand more things and the cost burdens you're putting on businesses that are already pressed with everything else they've got to do. There may be big data, electronic filing of tax returns every quarter, things like that, will begin to help cut that Gordian knot, but it's a difficult problem.
This is not an advertisement for EY, but we've just published a report that Group Eurotunnel asked us to produce, which was really looking at the traffic through the Channel Tunnel. Because although they understand their customers, they weren't really sure the exact details of that. And it's a public report. We actually presented it to a group of MPs in the House of Commons. But, some interesting things there. We surveyed 200 of their customers that, the West Midlands is the biggest origin and destination of things that pass through the Channel Tunnel. And it turns out that's parts for the car industry who are operating on two-hour supply chains. So if they don't get a delivery every 2 hours, effectively they have people and factories and they're not working. But the second largest category, I think, was courier parcels, which is really online shopping. So people who offer, online delivery within a day, it's very important. So one thing you could think of at least, and only be a partial solution, but is that the Scottish ports and airports, you might want to think about some sampling in the short term just to help you as you're obviously forming your view on what Brexit and the trade negotiations might look to just get at least some picture of where the sensitivities are in Scotland. And our experience is the operators of ports, airports and etc. will have really quite detailed knowledge of those operations and some of the challenges. So that would be something you might think about.
Okay. It's worth pointing out that actually in the same piece of work we did pick up actually, movement of fresh produce from Scotland to the continent. With the Channel Tunnel being quite a vital link.
Thank you. Marie.
On that, thank you, Convener. On that very note, I represent the Highlands and Islands of Scotland, so we've got a very strong tourism sector and a very strong food and drink sector, as you say. I'm interested in what you've noted about the concerns around free movement of people. So I know anecdotally, when I was visiting Shetland a couple of weeks ago, there's fish processing plants where more than half of the staff are EU nationals. And Shetland has very low unemployment rates. There's no local people looking for jobs. So what would be the impact of a very hard Brexit with no free movement of people on sectors like food and drink and tourism, which also has a huge number of EU nationals working in it?
Well, it's obviously a huge challenge. You might find that there's more, paradoxically, there's more investment in kit that does stuff instead of people, but that's, there's clearly huge limits to that, particularly in the tourism industry. you know, impact on costs because you're trying to bring people in from rest of UK instead of or other parts of Scotland rather than, but then you get into housing issues, I guess, in the Highlands. I suspect one of the big effects is what we've seen in the US. You get a lot more illegal migration going on as people try to find ways round to solve their particular business problems and take risks.
There's also, I guess, I suppose, some concern about, you know, there might be more complicated effects as well as the free movement of people. There's the issue of currency. So last year we had a very strong year tourism-wise in the Highlands and Islands, probably because of the crash in sterling. But obviously there are impacts going on. Do you want to tell me a little bit about your thoughts about how that's going to pan out in future?
Yeah, I mean, next year, in tourism terms, should be even better because most of the models of tourism flows suggest that, you know, while you get some immediate effect from a currency depreciation, the big effects actually take time to come through, particularly for far-travelled tourists. So tourism ought to be a bright spot through next year. But at the same time, there's the other side of the depreciation that we've not talked about, and it's likely to start rearing its head as we go into 2017, and that's increasing prices. The depreciation is so large that I don't think that's going to have an impact on the tourism sector particularly.
But I think the exchange rate could be as significant as Brexit in itself in terms of what happens in the UK economy. So we've obviously had a significant devaluation. I think there's an argument that the UK's current account was such that devaluation was probably going to come at some time, and Brexit may have sort of hastened that push. Well, we did a survey of our clients in the UK, and 67% think sterling will be back to the pre-referendum level within 2 years, you know, which I would say certainly against the dollar looks optimistic. But what that might mean at the moment, to your point, is that, and Dougie's point, we're seeing the short-term benefit of lower prices, but the question is, will businesses actually move to allocate capital to that export opportunity, which could be a way of driving productivity and growth, but equally, how will they look at the import side, where costs will rise, and will we, for example, see people trying to substitute some of the imports that we currently have? And the UK has been a great offshore of activity. Will some of that come back? So potentially, you know, there could be an opportunity wrapped up in that. Labour is obviously a different area, but it'll be interesting to see if businesses respond to that. And that's why business investment is uncertain, but it's so critical, because actually now would be the opportunity to invest in those exchange rate related opportunities, both export and import. But if businesses don't see the exchange rate shift as a permanent one, then clearly that investment isn't going to happen for a while. So it will be an interesting dynamic, I think, there.
And thinking even further ahead to how the whole Brexit negotiation might pan out, if there is an issue in terms of free movement of people, in terms of visitors coming to the UK, obviously, the area that I represent is pretty concerned about, you know, the idea that European people might need to get visas to come and visit us in the Highlands and Islands. And also food and drink being exported, what sort of trade tariffs there might be imposed on, you know, we've got whisky, salmon is one of the biggest export products for Scotland. Could you give me some of your thoughts on that going forward, please?
I mean, it is it's very speculative, unfortunately, because there are so many moving parts, you know. And I think in food and drink, another option or another area is, for example, if we do start to sign trade deals with other countries, then potentially there are an opportunity for more imports in some categories. You know, the EU, the customs union, obviously it's, to some extent protects food and drink that's within the EU, and some of the highest external tariffs are obviously on dairy and other products. So you know, I think you're right. There's obviously risks around people, but there's risks around tariffs, but there's also risks on the non-tariff side in terms of being able to to export, being able to get customs clearance quickly and prove the origin of those goods. So one would imagine that in the worst case, it obviously is going to be you know, a negative impact. Equally, you know, the more and the recent signalling suggests that all options are in play, that you might try and mitigate that. So I think the range is, as we saw at almost the time of the referendum, when, you know, obviously our profession took a bit of stick at that time, but you know, the general view was, with restrictive trade and migration, the net would be that I think amongst 80% of economists, GDP would be lower in the long run. So it's kind of all to play for, but there are some definite risks out there.
Adam Tompkins.
Thank you, Convener. I wanted to just to change focus a little bit from the least densely populated part of Scotland to the most densely populated part of Scotland, and to ask you a few questions about the very helpful but slightly depressing analysis at the end of your report on the city focus, and in particular on Glasgow, because that's the city where that I represent, but also because it's the city in Scotland with the first city deal. And to ask you about a couple of your remarks in the context of the city deal. So you write that Glasgow has experienced a 0.1% increase in employment that lags behind both Scotland and the UK as a whole, and indeed that over the period 2016 to 19, employment in Glasgow is likely to be flat. Now, the Glasgow city deal, which was signed a couple of years ago, was the first to be signed in Scotland, was at the time it was signed the richest anywhere in the UK, worth more than 1.1 billion to the local economy, and its purpose was to boost jobs in Glasgow. And by Glasgow, I don't just mean the city, I mean the Glasgow and Clyde Valley region. Something like 28,000 jobs are supposed to be generated directly as a result of the city deal. Are we to read your paragraphs in this report on Glasgow as a reflection of the failure of the Glasgow city deal, given that jobs growth is forecast by you to be so flat and so disappointing at the time that the city deal is in operation?
Shall I answer that?
Yeah, I can follow up.
Yeah, okay. So I think the way to put that into context is the city deal was created at a time when macroeconomic conditions were expected to be more favourable. So I think what we're seeing now when we look at the employment outlook, if we look across the UK, we think only London and the South East are going to see employment creation in the next 3 years, that actually employment is going to be falling and reasonably significantly in most parts of the UK, even say the North West and Yorkshire, where we talk about the Northern powerhouse. So I think we have to look at employment from now going forward in terms of that macro environment. So I think it would be too big a step to say that we should challenge the benefits of the Glasgow city deal based on a different employment profile now than what we thought previously on that. And I think what you do see in Glasgow is still growth in services such as professional services, but with public sector spending continue to be squeezed, you see job losses sort of mitigating some of that. So probably the macro context makes it hard now to evaluate the plan as was against that forecast. Is that fair?
Yeah, no, absolutely. The only thing I'd add is I'm not extremely familiar with the actual detail of you know, the programme and project level activities of the Glasgow City deal, but it is over a 10-year period.
Indeed.
And obviously those programs and projects should actually, you know, suit the macroeconomic and local economic environment that they're facing. So, you know, you would still actually hope that an injection of additional investment would actually be supportive. Obviously, within the context of what's happening in the broader economy, there might be job losses elsewhere for other reasons, which is actually kind of netting it out.
Yeah, but one would indeed hope. But against what kind of criteria should we now measure the realism of this hope, given that, as you've just said, the macroeconomic circumstances are different from those in which the Glasgow City deal was signed, particularly given that we're not only talking about Glasgow City deal, we're talking about the, you know, the growth of city deals throughout Scotland. I think every city in Scotland is to have a city deal, and now we're talking about growth deals away from cities as well. What are the kind of how would we measure the success or otherwise of these city deals and growth deals if the measurements are different from those which were assumed at the time that the Glasgow deal was signed 2 years ago.
I mean, we've been talking with the Scottish Cities Alliance about how you might benchmark that performance. But to put that in context of the UK regions and cities, London grew at, on average, 3.4% a year over the last 3 years. We now forecast it will grow at 1.9%. So you can see the macro effect hits everyone. I think the stronger you are, the more resilient you remain in the short term. And when we look at short-term outlook for cities, sector mix and the prospects for those sectors in the short term are a big driver of that. What I think, you know, might be the way to think about it is to think about some kind of benchmarking. And for example, Manchester has been outperforming other cities in its region, and it's obviously way further down the line in terms of its city deal. But if we look at Manchester's growth against what it was and also against its peers, we can probably start to derive some ratios as to what the growth effect looks to be relative to the investment we've got, and then think about taking that and looking again at the Scottish city deals in that context. So our discussions with the Scottish Cities Alliance have been not just looking at the Scottish cities relative to each other, but trying to look at where policy has made a difference. You know, the positive I'd take is that Manchester is outperforming, and it, for me, it does suggest that the devolution agenda across all of the cities and regions, there is an opportunity there to do something. Equally, it does take time. And, you know, we really need to understand the dynamics of what drives that. How important is infrastructure? How important is skills? And what's really the time period over which you might see a difference? So that would be my sort of suggestion, to think about trying to benchmark against some of the other deals which are now public and starting to develop across the UK.
The other consideration is actually just the sector makeup of a particular city. If you look at some of the cities that are actually forecast in our city forecast, they actually do quite well over the coming years. It's places like Reading, which are very weighted towards professional services, IT, scientific sectors. And those are the sectors that are actually forecast to do quite well across the UK. So I think it is important to actually look at, you know, each individual opportunity and see, you know, what the sector makeup is and how actually the macroeconomic environment is actually going to affect performance at the sector level.
Yeah, that's a good point. On our UK attractiveness survey last year, where Scotland had a strong performance, but what was, I think, most noticeable was in what I'd call the digital and knowledge industries. Both Glasgow and Edinburgh performed very strongly in terms of attracting FDI in those sectors, and I think that would be another dimension of this benchmarking is, you know, are you in the sectors where growth and opportunity seems highest, and really try and challenge that as well, because, you know, depending, you don't just want growth, but you want to think about the quality of growth as well. Is it creating a long term platform? And actually Scotland, with its universities, seems to be in a good position in that sense, but clearly the city deals need to really unlock that potential going forward.
Thank you very much, that's very helpful.
Awesome. Patrick.
Thank you. Good morning. I wanted to follow up on some of the questions that James Kelly was exploring on employment by sector, and then after that a question on forecasting more generally. I was a wee bit surprised at the description of the reaction to some of the impacts on gender inequality in employment as a mystery, you know, even in the context of the oil and gas industry and what's happened there. Yes, there are certain high-value parts of that industry which employ more men than women, but everything that we've heard all the way along is that it's the induced employment in the wider economy that's particularly vulnerable, and it seems to me that should have been expected. We're also looking at these sectors which suggest that these forecasts by sector which suggest that accommodation and food service will be the third biggest growth area, and the areas such as education, health and social care will be amongst the hardest hit. Again, we're looking at areas where women are more likely to be employed in those public services at a higher pay rate in the public sector than they would get for equivalent work in the private sector, and a growth in particularly low-paid jobs such as accommodation and food service. Isn't the picture that we're looking at, if we take all of this together, one of the likelihood of increasing stark inequalities, not just of gender inequalities, but of income inequalities in the Scottish economy? And doesn't that need to be the principal driver of Scottish Government policy, now that they're particularly reliant not just in achieving a social objective in reducing those inequalities, but particularly reliant on income tax revenues?
Yeah, I mean, I guess the public sector effects you're talking about are well documented, but have been going on for a long time. And yet we saw female employment rates and aggregate number of women with jobs in Scotland grow strongly until 2015. So maybe the oil effect is on women is a bigger effect than we're judging. But it doesn't quite feel right. I think we're living in a world where we have a major challenge on the equality agenda. If we think of the way that technology is disrupting so many sectors, so many places where there were good jobs in the past but are going to have fewer jobs in the future, albeit perhaps higher paid jobs, we have a major challenge to face in terms of how we distribute the gains from technology and to a lesser extent globalisation round the population. I think that's a well recognised problem across the West, and in Scotland shares it with everybody else. And I don't think there's any easy answers to it.
Any other comments on that? Particularly, I think Mark Gregory talked about education, health, and social care reductions in employment in the context of productivity. It seems slightly bizarre to use the same kind of definition of productivity in those areas where throughput for the same throughput with a lower labour input isn't an increase in productivity. It's a reduction in the quality of service, a reduction in what you're trying to achieve.
Yeah, and I was describing there very much the implied mathematical relationship, which is we are going to do more with less from that. You know, whether I think there's a...
Doesn't it actually result in doing less with less?
Well you know, I think there's a debate about productivity more generally, which is that we've defined productivity increasingly in terms of the cost side of the relationship, whereas actually the value side of the relationship may prove to be more important. And I can illustrate that. One of my clients is a financial services company, and they found out that their sales force was spending 11% of their time selling. And the reason was, yes, there was a lot of compliance they had to do, but the company had outsourced its IT, its finance, its HR. So actually the people who theoretically were there to create value were actually spending a lot of their time on activities which had reduced overall cost, but weren't necessarily maximising their resources. So I think we should be switching the productivity debate to where can we create value. And sometimes that might mean spending more money in the short term, because we're actually trying to get to a different output. So, I agree with you. I think we have to be very careful when we look at productivity to be sure that we understand what the benefit is we're trying to get and what the kind of multiplier benefit might be of that. So if we spent more on education or health, we got better outcomes, that might boost productivity at the macro level over time, because we'd have healthier people able to work more, or better educated people who one assumes would be able to produce more value, if you like. So I don't think that debate isn't in this, but I think that should be where the productivity debate should be.
Okay.
And just kind of stepping back a bit, when we're talking about kind of equality and the kind of inclusivist agenda, actually when growth is weakening, it actually becomes more challenging to achieve that. And you can see that on a regional basis in the ITEM regional report, where we have the impact of slower growth across the UK kind of propagating itself across the regions. And actually, some regions are actually more affected than others. And the regions are actually showing the lowest growth are the ones that were actually doing, at least well before any of the recent revisions. So I think, that kind of challenge is now become even more of a challenge given the change in the macroeconomic context.
Going to have to work harder. Actually, the tougher the economy gets, it's actually you need to do more to rebalance the economy or to address inequality than you do almost in a growing economy when you've got a bit more resource to move around there.
Well, I mean, there's another inequality paradox there. It's long been the case that high-paid people get paid more to make them work harder, and low-paid people get paid less to make them work harder. But I wanted to ask another question, just in more general terms, about forecasting and about how you do what it is that you do. it's sometimes said that nobody really predicted the financial crash. You know, actually, it's probably fairer to say that nobody using mainstream dominant economic theory predicted the financial crash. But, you know, a decade or so ago, there were people who were probably using less, maybe say, fashionable economic models, who did get the timing, the causes, and the extent of the financial crash right. What have you done to bring in a broader range of viewpoints and economic approaches in the time since then to try and ensure that we have a fuller range of understandings about the way that the economic discipline can be used to tell us something about where we are?
Dougie was telling me this morning he did predict the crash, but and I'm going to check on his report on that one subsequently, because he didn't actually sell any of his share portfolio, I'm sure.
Yeah, there was certainly a weakness in macroeconomic models in their treatment of the financial sector and the vulnerabilities there. And so I think models have tried to take account of the financial sector more, but in the way things, these kind of events come along, I suspect that, you know, it's not the last crisis we should be looking to, it's where the next one lies. So I think there's a new block in the model for the financial sector and its influence through the economy and credit spreads and stuff like that that wasn't there. So there has been some attempt to fix that particular issue with macroeconomic models. But there is a lively debate about you know, macroeconomics has never seemed a settled discipline.
I often see it argued that there isn't a lively enough debate about macroeconomics, and that
Reading the right blogs.
Maybe I would appreciate any links. But you know, one of the cases that's made is that the discipline involves people, perhaps in the way that some other academic disciplines do. Essentially having to talk the same language to one another and reinforcing the dominance of a sort of centrist approach and not exploring other economic models which have become unfashionable but which can prove useful. Is that a fair criticism?
I mean, you know, I think it is to some extent. I think the profession got itself somewhat isolated and a little bit hung up on the mathematical sort of solution to almost every problem, whereas, you know, we are trying to forecast in the UK how 65 million consumers will behave in their individual decisions, and you imagine sociology and other disciplines might actually be able to inform that to some extent. I think the problem you have is then trying to represent that in a model that works at an aggregate level. But, you know, I certainly think, as Dougie said, you know, that these models give you indications of direction of travel. I'm not sure they do pick sort of breakpoints in the trend. I think that's where there is a weakness, that if there is a shock that is outside the bounds, it's almost certain that we won't have captured that in the correct way.
Marie, did I see you saying you had a supplementary in this area?
Yes, I just wanted to clarify something. It was just on Patrick's earlier line of questioning about education and employment in education. Can I just clarify that I understood correctly? That table that we're looking at on sectoral outlook, you said earlier that the public sector spend, it wasn't modulated for the Scottish situation, and that it's...
be in next week's budget, for example?
So that table basically reflects the situation of spending at Westminster, and we can't really draw many conclusions about the Scottish situation from it. Yeah. OK, I just wanted to be clear on that. Thank you.
I've got Dean and Willie.
Thank you. Good morning. Your report highlights a number of concerns surrounding the recent and current performance of the Scottish economy. Pages 17 to 19 highlight concerns such as falling international exports, flat GDP, rising economic inactivity, and low job creation rates. Can you explain to us, to extent possible, are these caused by structural, long-term structural issues with the Scottish economy, or to what extent are they caused by shorter term changes in commodity prices such as oil and chemicals? Because From a policy perspective, we can try to address some of the structural issues, but we don't really have a lot of control over the price of oil or the price of chemicals.
Yeah. I think I probably said it in a kind of cack-handed way that the export performance was partly driven by compositional effects. We know what's the problems that have been faced by the metals sector over the last year, chemicals, price pressures in particular in that sector. So yeah, a lot of the particular issues are short-term cyclical ones, and some of them are ones that will be helped greatly by a sterling depreciation. But no doubt there are other structural issues at work as well. It's in terms of the makeup of the Scottish economy. But you know, the Scottish economy is structurally much less vulnerable now than it was, say, 30, 40 years ago, when it was very heavily dominated by capital goods production.
Just as some supplemental on this, you mentioned earlier the increasing divergence between the performance of the Scottish economy and the rest of the UK. It's a similar question, but can you talk us through what the main drivers of that divergence is? Because it appears to be increasing to some extent.
Well, one big driver is population. Our population is growing. It's much bigger now than we expected it to be, say, 10 years ago. But it's not growing as fast as particularly the southern part of the rest of the UK. So that has an immediate knock-on to GDP growth. Our aggregate rate of productivity growth seems to be a bit lower than the average for the UK as a whole. Again, that probably comes down to sector composition and the very fast productivity growth we've seen in some sectors in London, which is a kind of unique situation. So those would be the two main things that I'd point at. The public sector is a slightly bigger weight in the Scottish economy, and we know the pressures it's been under. So that would be another contributor to that gap. And then in the short term, we've had the commodity price effects and the oil price effects.
My final question relates to exports. 50% of all exports in Scotland come from 50 companies. And on page 17 of your report, you highlight declining international exports. Is there a structural issue in the Scottish economy that prevents more companies exporting? Is there a cultural issue? Have you seen any compelling reports or research as to why that's the case?
Exporting is difficult. It's not an easy thing to do. If you're a medium-sized company, it's a big commitment of resource with uncertain payoff. So exporting is difficult. And some of the models of trade and exporting that have proved fruitful in recent years have been focusing on the quotient of leading sectoral companies you have in your economy. So you know, you may have quite a large number of companies in a given sector, but only the leaders, the real leaders, are likely the ones that are exporting. So it's a compositional effect at the industry level there that you see. So if a business is a lifestyle business, I mean, I'm not saying somebody wants to work one day a week, but if it's a business that doesn't want to take many risks, it can make a good return for its owners and for its employees, then you know, the step to exporting can be a big risk.
Just on that, and we've made this point certainly at the UK level with UKTI as well as now DIT. I think we often focus on exports, whereas we should look at trade, and by that I mean the link to foreign direct investment, but also very much how those bilateral relationships evolve over time. And I think, you know, I'd argue that Germany is an exemplar of that, which is its trade with China is very much two-way, and over time you get leverage from that. I think at the UK level, and I'm not familiar at the Scottish level, we haven't often linked the pieces of trade together. So if you do go as a Scottish company and make an investment in a European country, that's over time likely to build relationships and create soft power. So actually your exports and your investment become linked in a different way there. So I think that will be probably increasingly important for all of us if the current Brexit process continues as it is and Scotland thinks about its role as a trading nation.
Okay. Well, with two-thirds of world growth coming from the emerging markets, does that mean over time, over the short to medium, longer term, most of our or more of our exports will go to those emerging markets?
I mean, yes and no. I mean, I think the opportunity's there, but it partly depends what you produce and where the opportunity is. And I think what we've seen, particularly in our foreign direct investment, is North America remains a very attractive market for Scottish producers, and we see the FDI coming in as well. So I think it will be still balanced. And yes, there'll be some faster growing pieces, but actually, what you produce may well play more in other markets.
Okay. Thank you.
I think related to the question from Dean, it's been striking me something you said earlier, and it's related to what Dean was following up on. You said that in terms of your forecast, that only in London, in the southeast, was employment forecast to grow. Now, obviously, the fiscal agreement that's been signed between the UK and the Scottish governments, the relative tax take issue, becomes very significant for us. Now, that was to be a factor in terms of the forecast that you have. There are real risks there for the Scottish economy. So I think my question is, what could the... Because both the Scottish and UK governments are responsible for this area. Mm-hmm. So what could both do to help the Scottish budget in these circumstances? And maybe there's something you can answer today, but certainly it's going to be very important for us in the future in terms of the tax state for Scotland to understand what we can do from both governments about how we can begin to impact on that.
Look, I think it's interesting to observe that in the autumn statement, the accompanying OBR report, that the anticipated take for income tax at the UK level has been falling. So that's an issue that's happening at the UK level. And if you're looking at basically where the weight of funds are being collected in Scotland, if that's in income tax, then that's obviously something to keep an eye on.
Well, any suggestions you have later to how we might address that, I think would be helpful. I saw a very interesting article in the Financial Times last week that said that there'd been a 25% increase in the number of corporations as people try to avoid paying income tax and move it in a different way. There are obviously significant dangers in there for the Scottish economy as well, because we've no control over that area. So it's a comment I make.
For example, we talked about export data, but actually employment data is also very problematic, and we don't really understand the self-employed economy in terms of what people actually earn in that, how they contribute to the tax system. All of our labour data is largely sample based, and the samples become, certainly at the UK level, very, very small relative to the increasing number of people who are self-employed. So when you're thinking of employment taxes, for example, that becomes quite a significant, or income taxes, that becomes quite a significant issue.
Because the interesting thing is, you change tax here, it may actually reduce your tax take and improve the Treasury's position, which would be a bit perverse of us if some people were to do that. So understanding all these things is going to be important. Sorry. No. Willie.
Thanks very much, Convener. I wonder if I could ask you for some comparisons between the Scottish economy and the Irish economy. Mark, you're chief economist for the UK and Ireland, and you mentioned it in your opening remarks. According to your forecasts in the paper you've given us, GDP forecast for Scotland's about 0.4, UK's about 0.8, but the Republic of Ireland's looking at something like 3.6, which is 9 times higher than Scotland. I mean, Ireland's come from a particularly difficult place in terms of the banking crisis, depopulation, and in my view, it doesn't have the strengths that Scotland's economy does have in food and drink and life sciences, financial services. So why would their forecast for growth be so much higher than Scotland's?
You're right. And certainly whenever we produce our forecast for a Republic, and I was reading our latest one yesterday in draft, you have to kind of start from some very strange numbers. I think, you know, there was Ireland was getting up to a reported 26% growth in GDP earlier this year, which was driven by sort of various classifications of leasing companies and some tax inversions. But we do think, you know, Ireland is growing at a healthy rate and may have grown sort of last year by 5-6% real after, you know, which is some of the bounce back from these things. You know, I think what Ireland has been very successful at is really developing its tech sector and its attractiveness to tech and life sciences. And actually, that isn't always its domestic capability, but it's been able to get inward investment from the US tech sector. I think if you look on the West Coast, for example, there. So partly that slightly distorts the numbers because there's a lot of sort of products that come in that leave, which don't necessarily have a massive Irish input, but nevertheless contribute to GDP. But also Ireland has you know, restructured its economy since the financial crisis. You know, companies did cut nominal wages, not just stop giving people pay rises, but they actually did take cost out of the labour supply, and that competitiveness is now coming back. And I suppose we may also see people sort of hedging their options in terms of whether they have operations in Ireland versus the mainland of the UK, given potentially one will be in the European Union in the long run and one won't. But I think they have had, you know, they've used tax policy very aggressively. I think that's well documented in terms of having a very competitive exchange rate. But they have been successful at targeting certain sectors with FDI, and that's provided a boost to the economy. You know, I think there still are challenges with the banking sector that have to be worked out over time. And probably property too, but you know, Ireland has really worked hard at trying to change the nature of its economy in the last few years.
But even looking forward to a potential Brexit impact on Ireland, we are their biggest import destination.
Yeah.
So if they're looking at a situation, say 2019, where the UK is out with the European Union, they're still in, but they're still forecasting healthy, significant growth rate. So why would they have that kind of huge differential though between themselves and Scotland?
I think partly, you know, people may not yet be baking into those forecasts the Brexit impact in the same way as, you know, we're assuming, if not cake and eat it, but, you know, that the kind of base case is there's some kind of reasonably smooth transition, which is only one of a range of possible scenarios. So I think that is probably, you know, the most significant factor in that at this point. I think forecasts for Ireland, like the UK, beyond 2019 are even more speculative than normal, if you like, in that context.
Good. Thank you.
Ivan, then Neil.
Okay. Thanks, Convener. Thanks for coming to talk to us today. I wanted to talk around some stuff to do with exports and Brexit, but just first clarify the point and answer to Ash Denham's question. We talked about export statistics. So if I heard you right, what you're saying is there is uncertainty around about those statistics, and in particular if we are trying to understand where Scotland's exports go in terms of is it our UK, is it Europe, or is it the rest of the world, there's considerable uncertainty about what those numbers actually are. Mm-hmm. Yeah, okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Looking through the report, we're talking about a WTO rate on beverages, for example, 20.7%. So that would hit Scottish whisky exports, potentially. Okay. And in talking about WTO, and that's talked about as an option, is it true to say that the UK at the moment, its situation vis-a-vis the WTO, is that the deals that the UK has with non-EU countries through the WTO are effectively by virtue of their membership of the EU,
yes.
So anything that's in place at the moment between the UK and a non-EU country, by and large, would have to effectively be started from scratch again. So you'd be back to square one.
So the idea would be that should the UK go down the WTO option, I saw government ministers yesterday, I think in the select committee, talking about, or maybe it was experts, that we try and grandfather the relationship. So you take what we have now as our WTO tariffs schedule effectively through the EU and move that over. I think the challenge is less on tariffs, it's on quotas, because often there's a set of quotas that sit with those tariffs, and you obviously have to agree with the EU how you divide those quotas. So that's probably the more challenging piece on that.
Yeah, but I mean, that is a big, big assumption. Because that's not the way business is normally done with regards to
Well, as I understand it, and, you know, I was talking to Duncan earlier, trade is, the more you understand it, the more you don't understand it, as a kind of, someone who hasn't really spent their career doing that. But clearly, you are subject to a challenge by any WTO member in that process. And there are obviously 160 or whatever, so there's clearly scope for someone who will see an arbitrage opportunity. So there is a risk there, for sure.
And just a separate issue with regards to exports, you quote some balance of payments, current account numbers in here, and the UK is about -5% plus or give or take a bit in terms of percentage of GDP on its current account. My understanding is that Scotland's got a positive balance of payments on the current account. Would that be correct?
I think it's hard to know.
Because of what we talked about earlier.
Hard. It's very hard to know. It's hard to know in the trade stats. I think the trade stats in the national accounts are as good as anybody can do. Flows of profit payments, interest payments. You know, all these things are kind of difficult to get a handle on that affect the current account position. So I think it's a difficult to know. I've seen some attempts at putting some numbers together, but
I'm sure there's nothing there that says this is what it. I mean, you'd assume, given offshore exports, given food and drink whiskey exports, given financial services, given a whole bunch of sectors, that it would be positive. But you're saying there's nothing hard and fast.
Hard and fast, and you know, we've seen much faster import growth than export growth over the last year, UK. Our rest UK companies, foreign companies operating in Scotland, repatriate profits, pay interest and dividends, which affect the current account. So it's not just about trade; it's about other.
And in fact, the ONS put out a paper last week where I think since 2011, the UK current account has gone from, let's say, -3% to -6% of GDP, and most of that decline is due to a fall in the return on investment overseas. And I think our return on capital has gone from 8-something to 5% on that. So, and I imagine potentially Scotland is disproportionately exposed to that because you've had a strong financial sector, so there's a good chance that actually you've got a disproportionate share of Britain's overseas investment, if you like.
Okay. So the last question I've got, and this is a hard one. So,
unlike the others.
They're just a warm-up. This is clearly written in the context of Brexit and where we are today, given we're 6 months after the vote, etc. If by, let's ignore how that process would happen, but if we woke up tomorrow and Brexit was off and you revised those numbers, how much better would they be?
Good question.
It's a good question. We've talked about the uncertainties around business investment. We've talked about the uncertainties around trade and foreign direct investment. If those... those uncertainties were X'd out, then I think you would see the numbers being quite a bit better.
You know, at the UK level, I think we started off at 2.7% at the start of the year. We're now at 1.9%, probably. And if some of that decline was because the economy was slowing in the run-up to Brexit, which we won't get back, but there's probably 20% of that 1.9%. So maybe we would be at 2.3% for the UK. So I don't know if you can read that across to Scotland, but it feels like that's the kind of slowdown we've probably seen. But it is hard to call because we are, actually, to Patrick's point, we're trying to forecast intentions at this point, how people are reacting to a somewhat uncertain environment. So that's why it's so difficult, because people are not necessarily behaving as we think they should be yet.
But if that uncertainty was lifted.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
There's actually a harder question than even that question. Usually when an economy is hit by a shock, you have bad effects. Yes. But then, over time, it adjusts and it kind of catches a lot of the damage up. And the issue now is, what are the long-term effects of Brexit? How does it affect our labour supply, our investment spend, and so on? And you can make arguments on both sides. And so the bigger question is, what is the impact on the UK's and Scotland's economic potential? And our economic potential... has a big impact on what we'll raise in terms of taxes and what we'll have available to devote to the good things that we all want.
The other interesting thing, particularly we were talking earlier in the Scottish context, is the savings ratio is relatively as low as it's been, I think, in Scotland. And normally, in times of uncertainty, the savings ratio goes up. that, and actually part of the reason for the slowing of the economy that people have been forecasting across the UK was we thought consumers would start saving more, but actually they've continued to spend, and Scotland is at the almost extreme end of that, so maybe there's less upside in the sense, as it stands, the Scottish consumer seems to be ignoring Brexit at this point, or you know, they think the rainy day is going to be so wet that actually they're going to spend it now before it happens, so that's why trying to flip that can be quite hard, I think.
And I wonder if there's other issues like the current account deficit, which is, you know, kind of maybe been exposed to the Brexit process so far, whether actually if Brexit was off, whether that issue would go away. I think it would still be there.
Yeah.
So I don't think everything would reverse.
Okay. Thank
Leo.
You.
Leo? Just wanted to ask you about exports and productivity and the forecasting in relation to Scottish Government targets. In 2014, Scottish Government said they wanted to increase exports by 50%, value of Scottish exports by 50% by 2017, and a target of being in the ranking in the top quartile for productivity against key OECD trading partners by 2017. Obviously, 2017 isn't that far away now. It was just to ask you how far or how close will we be to hitting those targets? And also, notwithstanding everything you said about Brexit, would it be fair to say those targets were challenging even before Brexit to be hit?
Yeah, I mean, they're challenging targets, and one of the issues with a target that's put in value terms, you can have an industry that's really doing quite well in terms of volume of production, but if prices are crashing through the floor as they have in some industries, then you can't get the value up. You say you're selling plenty, but you're not getting much for it, and the productivity issue we have in Scotland, as we have in the rest of the UK, this long period where we've not seen aggregate productivity grow very much at all, and that may be because we've taken different choices. We've got, if we look across to France and Germany, which are often held up and are major economies within OECD and are often held up as having high productivity. Certainly, if you look at France, they have high productivity, but they also have very high unemployment. So, you know, we've got a different mix, and growing productivity fast has lots of good effects, but it can also have some negative effects for some people.
Yeah, I think at the UK level, the George Osborne set a target of £1 trillion of exports by 2020. You know, and I think if you look at the item forecasts, we think probably with the kind of exchange rate boost, you may get to £700 billion, but by that time. So the UK is going to be some way off. There are several item club reports. We've done special reports on exports, and you know, the conclusion is not particularly startling, but is that you need to be selling the things that the fastest growing markets want to buy to actually really improve your export performance. And I think we talked about very much on the, you know, helping exporters access markets, but there needs to be much more on the supply side of the economy around investment, both in the infrastructure to enable exporting generally, but the skills and the sort of push into the right sectors. And I'm not sure that the UK as a whole has really ever had an integrated plan that would make that happen. So all of these targets are always going to be challenging unless there is much more push behind them.
Thank you very much for coming along today. It's been a fascinating session. I've certainly learned a lot from that process. We've got HMRC next week, so I think you've probably teed quite a few questions up for us.
Good luck with
in
that.
In terms of your responses today. So thank you very much. I now close this session of the committee.